I'm going to focus on one sort of often overlooked but very important component of labor market tools, their enforcement. Because even if we have the most optimally designed system of employment protections, if there's not strong enforcement to go along with it, they will mean nothing. I'm going to focus everything around violations of wage and hour laws. So I will refer to that as wage theft throughout this report, but everything I talk to can pretty much also apply to health and safety standards, to protections against employment discrimination, and to labor law and everything else. The most obvious form of wage theft is when someone is paid below the minimum wage. Another thing that includes is when employers misclassify employees as independent contractors, and then they don't comply with wage and hour laws. Another is not being paid for the hours that you work. This kind of thing is really prevalent. Say you are working late at a convenience store and your supervisor says, clock out and then clean up. For overtime eligible workers, not being paid time and a half when you work more than 40 hours a week is wage theft. Illegal deductions from pay. So employers can't, for example, deduct the cost of a uniform from a worker's paycheck if that means that they then make less than the minimum wage. Tips are legally the property of workers. They cannot be taken by employers or supervisors, but they can pretty easily end up in the wrong hands. So there was a survey of 4,300 workers in low-wage industries in Chicago, LA, and New York. And what it found is that of the workers surveyed, two-thirds experienced at least one pay-related violation in any given week, and that violation amounted to 15% of their earnings. So putting those numbers together, on average, the low-wage workers in those places reported losing about 10% of their earnings to wage theft. Total wages stolen from workers due to minimum wage violations alone exceeds $15 billion annually. And just sort of extrapolating from existing studies, a very back-of-the-envelope estimate suggests that in aggregate, low-wage workers lose on the order of $50 billion a year to all forms of wage theft. And just to add a little context to that, according to the FBI, the total value of all robberies, burglaries, larceny, and motor vehicle theft is $13 billion annually. Lawmakers allocate far, far fewer resources to combating wage theft, even though the problem is much larger in magnitude. The fact that this employer behavior is not competed away underscores that for a variety of reasons, these workers do not have the ability to quit these jobs as a form of enforcement. So federal resources for the enforcement of worker protections have declined. Of course, the U.S. workforce has grown. So, for example, in 1978, there were 69,000 workers per wage and hour investigator on average. Today, that ratio is 175,000 to 1. This means that there is a very, very low chance that any violator will get caught. So this low chance of getting caught combined with extremely low penalties that are in place for violations mean that there is almost no financial incentive for companies to comply with the law. I think it is not a stretch to say our system of worker protections largely relies on managerial goodwill for its enforcement. An increasing number of corporations are forcing their employers to sign away their rights to their private right to pursue justice in court if their employer violates their rights through mandatory arbitration. So in mandatory arbitration, I, as the employer, require you, as the worker, as a condition of employment, to sign a contract that says that if I violate your rights, you cannot bring me to court. You cannot sue me in court. Instead, disputes must be resolved by a private arbitrator that is chosen by the employer, where the arbitrator typically knows that if they rule in favor of the employer, they are more likely to get future business from that employer. So unsurprisingly, the outcomes for workers in this setting are much, much worse than outcomes for workers in the court of law. Survey data shows that today more than half of private sector non-union workers are subject to mandatory arbitration agreements, and that's up from less than 8% 25 years ago. So doing just a very back of the envelope extrapolation, I project that within 5 years, more than 80% of private sector non-union workers will be subject to mandatory arbitration. Recent Supreme Court decisions gave the green light to mandatory arbitration with class and collective action waivers. So why is that a problem? Class actions are an essential component of private enforcement because individual lawsuits are often unrealistic for low and even middle wage workers because the cost of the litigation, the cost of the legal representation typically exceeds the lost wages. Class and collective actions allow workers to aggregate their claims, mitigate, making the litigation cost effective. In 2015 and 2016, the top 10 private wage and hour class action settlements alone exceeded the combined total wages recovered by all state and federal enforcement agencies. So given the low government funding for enforcement, mandatory arbitration removes essentially all remaining financial incentives companies have to comply with the law. Another contributor to pervasive violations is workplace fissuring. So it used to be when you walked into a hotel, basically everyone who's working in that hotel is employed by the firm whose name is on the front of that hotel. But since around the 80s, employers have begun contracting out for many services, and particularly labor-intensive services. Now you have all these satellite wage setters who are all competing on price for contracts. And their biggest cost is labor costs. So cheap contracts mean that contractors face great pressure to cut corners on labor costs, including through violating wage, through violating labor and employment laws. A final reason I'll discuss for prevalent violations of worker protections is declining unionization. A key thing is that unionized workers are much less likely to be victims of wage theft and other violations because unions provide support, leverage, representation to workers in claiming their rights, along with protections against retaliatory firing. Over the last 40 years, the share of workers covered by a collective bargaining agreement has dropped from over 25% to less than 12%. So I will quickly cover what we need to put in place to have an effective enforcement system that would incentivize employers to comply with the law rather than shirk. So the most obvious thing is we need more resources to go to enforcement of worker protections. In addition to the very, very obvious things, like we just need more wage and hour investigators, there are a bunch of more novel things that can be taken up that are being experimented with in some states. So for example, state attorneys general offices can help protect workers' rights. Some have set up labor branches and are using their authority to enforce state laws to do things like investigate and file suit against companies who are cheating their workers. Employers should not be able to ask their workers to sign away their right to their last layer of enforcement, the courts. So a ban on mandatory arbitration can be done by federal legislation. In the meantime, states can and are enacting what are known as whistleblower enforcement laws that they allow workers who are subject to mandatory arbitration to sue lawbreaking employers on behalf of the state, because the state is actually cannot be forced to arbitrate. So it's a cumbersome way to do it, but it's sort of a workaround while mandatory arbitration remains legal. As employers outsource various functions to contractors and subcontractors, it has become more and more possible for lead firms to evade liability for labor standards violations. So one solution is that all firms who share control over the terms and conditions of a worker's job, like all firms who share control over things like pay, over things like schedules, over things like job duties, they should all be considered employers of that worker or joint employers. Lead firms who are legally joint employers with their contractors would then not, for example, be able to put pressure on those contractors to cut corners with labor costs without facing liability for violations themselves. Another way to boost enforcement is to boost unionization, so more workers get the protections against violations that workers provide. And one thing I just always want to mention along these lines is that the decline of unions has not been a natural phenomenon. More people report that they want to be in unions now than 40 years ago, so it's not that workers don't want them. I think the decline of unionization has been due in large part to massively increased employer aggressiveness in fighting union organizing, and labor law has just not evolved to counteract that. all employers could be required to provide workers with statements of pay. When employers were required to provide workers with written notice of their terms of employment, which perhaps surprisingly is not required in most places, it helps reduce the noncompliance that results from it just being easy for employers to hide violations, and it provides employees with necessary documentation to pursue a claim in the event of a violation. And then lastly, I just want to add that every year, the government spends hundreds of billions of dollars on contracts, from everything from building interstate highways to serving concessions at national parks. The law should require that contractors competing for federal contracts disclose previous workplace violations. Agencies could independently firm that disclosure, and those violations should be able to be considered when awarding new contracts. So I will leave it there. I just hope this has been sort of a useful window into the importance of enforcement in designing effective labor market tools.